House Republicans did their level best in trying to tank this economy, that the Biden-Harris economy just continues to do well. 339,000 new jobs created in May, 13 million jobs in the Biden-Harris administration since they have taken office, and unemployment the lowest rate in 5 decades, all because of job-creating bills that were signed into law and where House Democrats played instrumental roles. We want to continue to build on this progress. We want to pass laws that open up clean energy projects and innovation, put people to work. We want to fully fund the bipartisan infrastructure bill and the CHIPS Act to ensure that we're creating jobs for the 21st century economy across every zip code in our country. And we want to make sure that our fossil fuel dependence continues to be reduced, as well as prices at the pump. But what do House Republicans have planned? This month, they have told their members that they are going to mark up over $3 trillion tax cut that would help the wealthy and the well-connected at the expense of everyone else. After crowing about deficits and debts for the last few months, we know that this is exactly what they had in mind. They want to make sure that they add trillions to the deficit before the chairman's birthday, which has been something that he has frequently told his members. They want to make sure that the burdens that families pay continues to rise, and the American people clearly will see through this hypocrisy. They will know exactly where House Republicans stand once they mark up this bill. That's what we have ahead, and House Democrats look forward to continuing to stand for progress and stand for job creation. Vice Chair Ted Lieu.
Thank you, Chairman Aguilar. Joe Biden is the jobs president. In the first 15 months of the Biden-Harris administration, over 10 million jobs were created, the highest in U.S. history. And as Chairman Aguilar stated last week, another terrific jobs report came out, exceeding expectations. Last week also showed that it was House Democrats that prevented MAGA extremists from harming American families. It was House Democrats that bailed out a rules vote when Speaker McCarthy couldn't get enough votes to pass a rule on a package he himself negotiated. It was House Democrats that also supplied the votes to get a majority for a package that Speaker McCarthy couldn't get enough votes just with his own caucus. And despite the best efforts of MAGA extremists to crash the U.S. economy, it was House Democrats that said no and stopped that from happening. And with that, I yield.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Brian.
Mr. Aguilar, I know you're blaming the House Republicans for the way these debt and ceiling negotiations came down, but it did end up being a bipartisan agreement, more than 300 votes, something we rarely see in the House of Representatives anymore. You're now heading into the debate over the budget, and you have to pass 12 appropriations bills. Are you hopeful, at least, that because this was able to be done through a level of bipartisan cooperation, that that same principle can be applied to the budget process? And instead of waiting until the last minute, are those negotiations already happening?
Well, first of all, Ryan, thank you for asking an appropriations question. This is, you know, my sweet spot here.
I know
So I appreciate it. Look, the House, and I think you'd also appreciate the appropriations process just operates a little different, right? Members generally want to work together. They want to get these bills out. That's something that brings both parties together, is to pass these bills. And hopefully the framework that has been adopted, again, like the Vice Chair said, 165 Democrats supporting that bill. We love every element of it, but it did create a roadmap to get these appropriations bills out. And hopefully both sides see that there is a benefit to getting these bills signed into law as well, because the non-defense cuts and the defense cuts that would trigger if we didn't pass a budget and pass these appropriations bills. So we're hopeful, we're optimistic that this framework will lead to good bipartisan bills. But that can only happen if Republicans tune out the extremism, not just in their conference, but now Speaker McCarthy has placed, you know, some of these extreme members on the Appropriations Committee as part of his deal when he was auctioning off seats and trying to get trying to get the speaker's gavel. So I think that that's something that is to be determined. Generally, the appropriations members are a little bit more reasonable, and we hope that it's that spirit that our colleagues carry forward. It's going to mean that these bills have to move forward in a bipartisan basis in order to be signed into law. So if Republicans have a choice, do they want extreme bills out of committee that will keep their conference together, or do they want bills that will have bipartisan support that are more likely to be signed into law and agreed to by the Senate? That's a decision for the Speaker and the majority.
Is that, if I can follow up, is that the first step in this process, though? I mean, the old appropriations process was bipartisan bills would emerge out of committee first and then go through the process. Then it's now gone to where a Republican-only bill and then negotiations after. Could it possibly happen where bipartisan bills emerge from the committees?
It's possible. The top line is gonna matter. The 302B number is going to be what we are looking at. And so, you know, to the extent that that top line appropriations number is reasonable, spread across the 12 bills, really 11 plus one, defense being the other, then we'll know. We'll know pretty quickly whether Sherrod Granger looks forward to a bipartisan process or whether this is going to be a show and we're just going to have to wait for the Senate to produce a product. Nick?
Also on appropriations, I wanted to ask about the Ukraine supplemental. Speaker McCarthy seemed to pour some cold water on one yesterday. What do you think the outlook is for any kind of supplemental Ukraine appropriation?
Well, look, I think we all stand, I think House Democrats stand united behind Ukraine, united behind a democracy. We have time and time again stood with our partners and friends in Ukraine. We look forward to seeing, but the next process would be the administration indicating that funds have been exhausted. And so let's let the process play out, see what the administration says. But I think I read those comments from Speaker McCarthy saying he is very mindful that the most extreme voices in his conference hold sway, just like they were able to get seats on the Rules Committee, just like they were able to get seats in the Appropriations Committee. He has a very strong anti-Ukraine faction within his conference that he's trying to navigate. And so let's see what the administration proposes, where the funds have been expended and what the timing of that is. Clearly, House Democrats will continue to be supportive of Ukraine moving forward. It's going to be on the Speaker as to whether this gets some floor time.
Can I ask your reaction to the whistleblower who is a former intelligence and military official saying that there's a government department that has, in fact, recovered UFOs and aliens, essentially, and that this department is keeping it secret from other agencies, including Arrow, including Congress? Do you know anything about recovered UFOs? And if not, what is your reaction to this?
This is not a question I had on my bingo card.
this is not your sweet spot?
Last week, it is not my sweet spot. Although I am a defense appropriator, I am part of classified briefings. This is nothing that has come up. I didn't read the article that you're mentioning. I saw it. I'll let the vice chair comment.
I mean, do you think, considering the Defense Department has said there are certain UFO videos to this point that we can't identify? I mean, is this outside the realm of possibility? Is this something that realistically Congress would look into after this?
In the Senate, I just refer you to the Senate testimony. There was a committee hearing, and there was members of the defense community who testified in public session. I would imagine that there will continue to be conversations and testimony in the future, but I don't have anything more to add on that.
Let's go back to your sweet spot. Let's go to appropriations. So a lot of Republicans are going to be asking for additional spending cuts when we get down to that budget process. Are you going to be open to that, or are you drawing a line in the sand?
Well, look, it depends on within that appropriations process. You know, like we said, we're viewing it as 11 bills plus one. Because the defense number was called for and is now a part of law, then there is the non-defense number with a healthy amount and continued funding for the Toxic Exposure Fund and our commitment to veterans. House Democrats see that as a success and a win. But let's see what the top lines look like for those other committees. House Republicans have shown time and time again that they want to reduce labor health funding. They want to reduce NIH. They want to reduce education funding. Let's see what they come back at. Let's see what those top line numbers look at, and then House Democrats and appropriators will take a posture and a commitment, and we will have those conversations in committee. We will have open amendment process. The Appropriations Committee is fun in that sense. You can offer changes from the floor. You can offer amendments by just standing up and working in a bipartisan way. So we look forward to that process playing out. But the next step is clearly those top line numbers, and we'll see the seriousness in which House Republicans want to treat this, and whether they want this to be a bipartisan process or not.
Yeah. I actually have a question for Congressman Liu, if you don't mind. Jim Jordan sent a letter to the Department of Justice this morning asking for an unredacted copy of the scope of the investigation that Jack Smith's doing. You're part of the Judiciary Committee. Does Judiciary have any reason to have access to this letter or to know the scope of the special counsel's investigation into the former president?
So Congress is their legislative branch. We do not interfere in ongoing law enforcement investigations. Law enforcement should be allowed to do its job. It is frankly outrageous that you have Chairman Jordan try to interfere in an ongoing federal investigation. And by the way, Department of Justice is just going to ignore it.
It's just a continued attempt, too. I mean, this is a House Republican conference that has talked routinely about defunding the FBI. This is a next step in that conversation, where clearly they are caving to the most extreme elements within their conference.
Maybe something else that's not on the bingo card. Coming up on the Dobbs decision, 1 year anniversary, talk to me a little bit about Democratic leadership and legislative, what can be done still.
You're going to hear us talk extensively about this over the month. And House Democrats are going to remind the public of the dangerous Dobbs decisions, because we stand for reproductive freedom and we believe that women should have control over their health decisions with consultation from their medical professionals and their family and their faith. That's what this is about. And the dangerous decision is something that the House Democrats will call attention to. But I would imagine that this is something that the public also remembers and will continue to be mindful of. Look, the only way that we make positive change in this realm is to safeguard these protections within law. And in order to do that, we have to win elections. And we're very mindful of that, and I think that will be an important component of the political calendar moving forward, because I think the public is very mindful of what happened, and we want to make sure that we call attention to it. And the House extremism, the House Republican extremism, that continues to support that.
Last question.
Chair.
What are your thoughts on the allegations that the Oversight Committee Chair James Comer is making with regards to holding Ray in contempt, and just the kind of document which he alleges has details in a Biden bribery scandal? Is this something that has all come up in Democratic leadership conversations? How are you viewing this whole situation with the Oversight Committee?
Most of what comes up in the Republican-led Oversight Committee is dangerous. It falls into either one or two categories: dangerous or laughable. And I think this is one that has maybe both of those elements. But what House Republicans are doing, is clearly down the road to continuing to support these seemingly political efforts to highlight the president and put him in a negative light. That's all this is about. They don't have to have information. They don't have to have backup in order to call a press conference and to make allegations. That's exactly what the chairman does time and time again. I trust that Democrats on the Oversight Committee will stand up to this and will continue to do well and represent us and House Democrats' interests moving forward as soon as there's more information. But right now, it's just press conference after press conference and allegation without proof. And I think that's what the American public sees clearly.
Chairman Aguilar?
I just want to say that these are the same allegations that Trump's own Attorney General Bill Barr took a pass on.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah.
It's the first time I've met him. What up, yo? It was bound to happen.
No, that happened to me, too. Remember, I don't know if you remember.
Yeah.
It was after I had called on it, after I had asked him about oversight thing. Last week, I think you asked. What did you ask last time?
Oh, just yeah.
Something not working.
Did you read that article?
No, I didn't.
I was off yesterday.
I didn't pay attention, but Playbook, it's like their third item in Playbook this morning.
Oh, really?
Apparently, the reporter's in Old New York Times report.
Oh, okay. So that's incredible.
At least on some level.
Yeah.
I mean,
we're never going to get called on.
The whistleblower. Like, is it a real person?
Sure.
The question
Jeffrey's
is
always called for me, so.
He called, yeah, and me too.
And he's
I mean, like, allegations that they have actually.